Okay, we are about to embark on a major endeavor in the history of Klal Yisrael, and that is Daf Yomi that's been around already. This is the 14th cycle since it began, so we're talking something about 91 years of Daf Yomi being learned, and it moves fast, and there's a lot of information and a lot of details that we need to and that we want to cover each and every single day. So in the beginning, because I myself never gave Daf Yomi shir before, we'll have to see exactly how it's going to work, question-wise and everything, interrupting and interjections while we're going through it. So I'm going to ask from the beginning the following. I'll ask that at least today, tomorrow, the next couple of days, till we get some kind of a groove going over here, that the questions are not really asked during the shir itself. If you have questions, you'll ask afterwards. I just want to make sure that we get through the material. And HaKadosh Baruch Hu should give us siyata d'shamaya. Those of us that are starting, we should have the strength. It gets rocky roads. There's difficult sugyas. There's difficult parts of Shas. Hard to understand. Difficult to be able to wrap your arms around, as they say. But the person shouldn't give up. Even the difficult ones, if you don't get it 100%, you don't get it 90%, you don't even get it 10%, it's okay. The point is, you just keep pushing and you keep going. We try to cover the ground, and we try to stay connected over here to the Torah. And this is a chelik, this is a portion of Torah that is connecting all of Klal Yisrael together. So we're going to start now with the beginning of Berachos and Daf Beis Amud Aleph, and I will try my best to translate things into English so that we should understand what is going on over here. The Mishnah starts off with the following: Me'emisai Kone Shema Ba'arvin. From when do we start reading the Shema Ba'arvin at nighttime? So the Mishnah is starting off with the following premise. There's a mitzvah of Kriya Shema, and the time, there must be a specific time that you're supposed to read that Kriya Shema at night to fulfill the obligation. So says the Mishnah, Mishah Shakahanim Nichnasim Lecha B'Chumasim. So when does it start that you're allowed to read the Kriya Shema at night? From the time that the Kohanim, in the days of the Beis HaMikdash, when there were laws of Tumah and Tahara, which are laws of purity and impurity, if a Kohen would become impure, which means, let's say, that he touched a dead body, so he'd have to go through a purification process. And towards the nighttime, he would end up going to the mikvah. And then after he would go to the mikvah, and the nighttime came, he was allowed to eat the truma, which are the gifts that are given to a Kohen. He was allowed to eat that produce from Eretz Yisrael that's called truma. And until when? At Saif HaAshmur HaRishayna, you would be able to say the Shema from the time that the Kohanim would be able to eat their truma until the later part of the night, which is the third, which is the end of the first watching, as we're going to see what that means later on in the Gemara, the end of the first watching that takes place in the evening. There are three watchings that take place. We're going to learn that on Daf Gimel. We'll see what that is. There are three specific times of the nighttime. There's the first watching, the second watching, and the third watching. So until when are you allowed to recite the Kriya Shema? Seemingly, what is considered to be still nighttime, that the Kriya Shema at nighttime is going to be allowed to be recited? That's going to be at the end of the first third of the watchings at night. That's Divrei Rabbi Eliezer. That's what Rabbi Eliezer tells us. The Chachamim argue on that. And they say, Ad Chatzais. So the Chachamim don't seem to be arguing on when are you allowed to start reciting the Shema at night. Everybody seems to be agreeing from the time that the Kohanim enter in to eat their Truma, which means sometime at nighttime. We don't know exactly what that hour is. But they argue on Rabbi Eliezer and they say, you're allowed to say the Shema later into the night, Ad Chatzais, until midnight. Rabbi Gamliel says, Ad Shiyalu Amashachar. So Rabbi Gamliel says, no, even later. Not only can you read the Shema until Chatzos, till midnight, you can actually read the Shema all the way up until Amud HaShachar, which is the first rays of day that are coming up, which, let's say, in English is about 72 to 90 minutes before the sun itself comes up. So you have a three-way machlekes, seemingly, three opinions over here in the Mishnah. Rabbi Eliezer is the most conservative, who says that you're only allowed to read it until the end of the first watch. The Chachamim say that you're allowed to read it up until Chatzais. And Rabbi Gamliel says you're allowed to read it until Amar Ashacha till the first rays of light are actually coming up. But everybody seems to agree in the Mishnah that when do you start reading the Shema at night? Again, we're assuming that there's a mitzvah to read the Shema at night. When is that mitzvah going to begin? From the time that the Kohanim are able to enter in and start eating the Truma, meaning they got a part of their purification process, and therefore they're now able to eat the Truma at that point in the evening. Rabban Gamliel Oimer. So this Rabban Gamliel. So there's a story that the Mishnah brings down of the children of Rabban Gamliel, who just told us you're allowed to read the Shema all the way up until Amud HaShachar, Alois HaShachar, when the sun is coming, when the first rays of light are coming up. So the story is the following. Uba'u bano mi beis hamishteh. His children came back from a beis hamishteh, from some kind of a celebration, a party house. And they said them leikarina shema. They said, Tati, we didn't read Shema. We were so busy at the banquet at the hall, we forgot to read the Shema. So Amar lehem. So he says to them, im lo yalo amar hashachar. If the first rays of light have not yet appeared, chayovin atem likreis. You are obligated to still read the Kri Shema. So there you see that his opinion that you fulfill your obligation of the nighttime reading of the Kri Shema all the way up until the first rays of light begin coming. V'loizu bilvad omro, says Rabban Gamliel, that not only is it on Kriya Shema that you are allowed to say it until Alois HaShachar, till the rays of light are coming up, ela kol ma sha'amu chachamim ad chatzos, whenever the sages said that you can only do a certain mitzvah until chatzos, until midnight, the mitzvah really extends all the way until Alois HaShachar, Amar HaShachar, till the first rays of light are coming up. So now Rabbi Gamliel is telling us that I'm not really arguing with the Chachamim. The Chacham and I are not arguing about what is the right time to end saying the Kri Shema, at whether it's Chatzos midnight or whether it's at Amar HaShachar when the first rays of light are coming up. We both agree that you could say the Kri Shema all the way up until Amud HaShachar, till the first rays of light are coming up. But the Chachamim said the words An Chatzos until midnight, as we'll see in the Mishnah, because they had a specific reason why they wanted us to keep in mind midnight instead of until the end of the night, which is the beginning of the day, as we'll see. So he says, every time that the Chachamim, that the sages said Chatzos, midnight, they really meant the mitzvah extends until Amud HaShachar, till the rays of light are coming up. For example, Hekter Chalavim ve'evarim mitzvasan Hashem HaShachar. You have burning of the fats and of the limbs of a korban of a sacrifice on the mizbeach, on the altar. You could do that all the way up until Amud HaShachar. Ve'kol ha'nechanun yomecha mitzvasan Hashem HaShachar. And any korban, any sacrifice which you would end up eating of the meats, you'd have one day to eat the meats of that sacrifice. And when the day would pass, whatever is left over is called noisar, it's called leftovers. And if a person would end up eating the meats of a sacrifice that were left over, their chayav karis, they get cut off. Says the Mishnah over here, any korban that a person is allowed to eat the meats of that korban for only one day, so when does the day end? It ends again, as he says, ad sheya'alu amar hashachar, until the first rays of light are coming up. I am Cain, asked the Gemara, asked the Mishnah, if that's the case, that really, even the Chachamim hold that you're allowed to do all these mitzvahs until the first rays of light, so then why did the Chachamim say, Lama Amr Chachamim al Chatzais? Why did they say you can only do the mitzvah until Chatzais, until midnight? Says the Mishnah, it answers, Kedei laharchik adam min ha'avera. Because they wanted to distance a person from Aveira, from sin. What does that mean? They understood that if you would think that you have all night long to say the Kriya Shema, then you would let time escape, and before you know it, what's going to happen is going to be morning time, and you did not say the Shema. This is a very important thing to remember, by the way. Sometimes when we daven on a regular weeknight, so we end up davening early. So that means that we davened Kriya Shema before it was actually the, as we'll see in the Gemara's over here, we davened Kriya Shema at night before it was the actual obligatory time to say Kriya Shema, which means you did not fulfill the obligation of saying the Kriya Shema. That's the Mishnah saying over here. There's a time. And if you say Kriya Shema before that time, you did not fulfill the obligation. So what does that mean? That means that a person must repeat the Kriya Shema later on at the appropriate time, because that's the only way you fulfill it. So a person will leave the shul. A person will leave the shul and they will think to themselves, well, I have until Amud HaShachar. I have until the sun is going, till the first rays of light are going to come up. I have plenty of time. And everybody knows what happens. You come home, you get busy with stuff. Your wife asks for this, the kids are asking for that. You get busy, you're tired, you fall asleep. The next thing you know, you wake up. It's after Amud HaShachar and you miss saying Kriya Shema for the mitzvah of saying Kriya Shema. So therefore, a person must be careful in those respects, says the Chachamim, that even though you have all the way up until Amud HaShachar, nevertheless, we want to be marchik, we want to distance you from making a mistake. So he said, ad chatzois, until midnight. You'll keep midnight as the goal in mind, and you'll do your best to get it done by then. If, God forbid, you didn't do it by midnight, you'll realize you still have extra time to do it, but you'll be aware of it. Now, Rashi just points out over here that if there really is a specific time to say the Kriya Shema, so, and that is nighttime. We don't know exactly what the definition of nighttime is yet, but it's going to be nighttime. So how do we have this custom that many shuls, as we just mentioned, have, where they daven mincha maariv back to back, and the sun is actually still somewhere in the sky that you can see. The moon is not up, the stars are not in the sky, it's not nighttime. So what are you doing when you say Kriya Shema over there? Why are we saying Kriya Shema if that's not the obligatory time? So Rashi writes the following: Im kein, lama korin oisa bebeis hakinesis. Why are we reading the Kriya Shema in shul by maariv when it's not the time for us to be able to fulfill the obligation? So Rashi says, the reason is kidei la'amoid b'tfila mitoich divrei Torah. Because even though that you're not going to fulfill the obligation of saying Kriya Shema when you're davening early, nevertheless, the Shema will count at that point as words of Torah. And it's a very nice thing to connect your Shmone Esrei, your tefillah, to words of Torah. And therefore, that's why we say the Kriya Shema. Not to fulfill the obligation when you're doing it early. You have to keep this in mind. You're not fulfilling the obligation of saying Kriya Shema when you daven early. You're saying Divrei Torah, words of Torah. And it's a nice way to introduce yourself into the Shmone Esrei. And therefore, he writes, Ulefikach, therefore, there's an obligation upon a person to read the Shema when it gets dark. Says the Rashi, his opinion is that, of course, everybody says Kriya Shema Lamita. They say the Kriya Shema before they go to sleep at night. And when they say the Kriya Shema when they go to sleep at night, it's enough to say the first paragraph of the Shema. And that, says Rashi, you'll fulfill your obligation in that way. Many of the other opinions are that, no, if you said Shema early, and you didn't say it at the right time, you actually have to read all three of the parshas of the Kriya Shema. Okay, that's the Mishnah. Says the Gemara the following: Tana Hechekoi. Where is this Tana? Where is the author of our Mishnah getting his understanding? Remember, he's asking as a very simple thing: from when do we read the Kriya Shema at night? What is the time to read the Kriya Shema at night? That means he has an assumption that there's actually a mitzvah to read the Shema. And he also has an assumption. Did someone turn on the air? Crazy. I think the air went. It feels like the air went on. Yeah, that the first of all, the Tana has an assumption that there is a mitzvah to read Kriya Shema. How do we know that? And second of all, he has an assumption that there's a mitzvah to read the Kriya Shema at night. Okay? So you start the Mishnah by telling us two assumptions already. Number one, there's a mitzvah to say Kriya Shema. And number two, there's a mitzvah to read the Kriya Shema at night. Why don't you, if there's such a thing, why don't you start off by telling us that there is, start off teaching us the mitzvah of Kriya Shema itself. Why start off with an assumption that there already is the mitzvah we don't even know about? So Tana Hechekoi, where does the Tana know this from? Tana, whenever we use the word Tana, that means the author of the Mishnah. The Ketani Me'emasai, he's asking Me'emasai, from where do we know that there's an obligation to read the Shema at night? Visu, and furthermore, Maishna, the Tani Ba'arvis Beresha, listening to Shachris Beresha. Why is the Mishnah also very unusual? You're starting off Shas over here, you're starting off the midst of Kriya Shema. And you would tell us, you know, what time is the obligation to the Kriya Shema at night? At night? What about the morning? Don't we start our day of Avodas Hashem in the morning? As Taisa says over here, what's the question? That there was something called a Korban Tamid. There was a daily offering that was brought. And the verse in the Torah, when it speaks about the daily offering, says it starts, we start with the morning one, and there's a night one as well. There's the one later on in the day. So you see that when it comes to avodah, when it comes to service, which is going to take place, we start with the morning, we don't start with the night. So why is the Mishnah over here telling us, when you're going to start reading the Krishna at night? Tell me, you have a mitzvah to say Krishna? Tell me when you're going to start saying the Krishna, the Shachris, in the morning. Says the Gemara, Tana Akrai Kai. Our Tana, the author of our Mishnah, the reason that he knows that there's a mitzvah to say Krishna, and the reason that he knows that we should start with talking about the one at night, is because it's based upon a pasuk, upon a verse. Dechsiv, like it says, B'shivcho v'kumecha. It says that when you lay down and when you get up, right? V'shinatu levanecha, you should teach over the Torah to your children. U'lechtecha v'derech, when you're going on the way. U'v'shivcho v'mecha, and when you lay down, and when you get up, you have an obligation to say the Shema, which means that there is a Torah obligation that a person has to say the Shema when they lay down, which means when they're going to the nighttime, ubikumecha, and when they wake up in the morning, when it's the daytime. So our Tana, the author of our Mishnah, understood that verse is the obligation that we have to say Shema. And if you look at the verse, what does it say first? Laying down, nighttime. Before the waking up, before the morning time. So therefore it understands, the Tana understood, that we're going to start off trying to understand the obligation of reciting the Shema from the night, and then we'll go to the morning. V'yachi getani. And this is really what the mitzvah should be saying. Zman kriya Shema, the Shchiva, the time of the Shema, of Shchiva, of laying down. Emas, when is that going to be? Mishasha kahanim nichnasin lecha b'chumasan. The Mishnah would be saying, when is the time to read the Shema when you're laying down? It doesn't mean the Kriya Shema of nighttime. It means the Shema, like it says in the pasuk, of laying down. What is the time of reading the Shema when you're laying down? That's when what? When the kahanim, who were impure, became pure, and now they're allowed to go and eat their truma at night. What exactly is that time going to be? We don't know what that time is going to be yet. So the Gemara says you could also learn out why the Mishnah started with the nighttime and not the daytime from Briyasa, from the creation of the world. Dichsiv, as we know, every Jew knows this. Everybody knows that the Jewish day starts at night. It was nighttime and it was daytime. Day number one, that's what it says in the creation of the world. So therefore, the Gemara is saying over here that yes, you could learn out from that pasuk, that one verse which talks about laying down and getting up, that's the obligation to say Shema, and that's why the Gemara starts off with the nighttime obligation over the morning obligation. But you could also learn out as a basic thing. The Jew knows that the daytime always starts at night. So since night always is the beginning of the day, that's why we're going to start off the first Mishnah over here in Shas with the obligation of saying the Shema at nighttime and not the one that we're going to say in the daytime. Ihachi, if that's the case, Seifa deketani b'shachar mevarech shtayim lefaneh v'yachas lachareha. So then we have a question, says the Gemara. Later on, the Mishnah is going to teach us the following. In the morning time of the obligation of saying Kriya Shema, you make two brachas before the Shema, v'achas li'achareh, and you make one bracha after the Shema. U'be'erev, and at night time, mevarech shtayim lefaneha. You make two brachas before you say the Shema, v'shtayim li'achareh, and you make two brachas after the Shema. So over there, later on in the Mishnah, as we'll see on Daf Yud Aleph, it tells us what? The morning before the night. In our Mishnah, we're learning about the night before the morning. Later on, when we talk about Shema, it talks about the morning before the night. Ask the Gemara, listening to Arvis Bereisha. Keep everything orderly over here. If you're telling me that it's so important to mention the night before the morning when it comes to the Mitzvah of Kriya Shema, so then over there as well, later on in the Mishnah, don't tell me that there's two brachas before in the morning and one bracha afterwards. Tell me that there's two brachas before at nighttime and two brachas two brachas afterwards at nighttime, and then go to the morning time. Why are you changing the order of events over here? So the Gemara says, Tana Pasach Ba'arvis, the author of our Mishnah, he started by talking about Arvis, talking about the obligation that we have to say the Shema at night. V'hadar Tani B'shachris, and then there's a Mishnah Daf Tes that begins to talk about the Kriya Shema, the obligation that we have in the morning time. Ad the koy b'shachris, once that he already started talking about shachris, about the morning obligation of kriya shema, parish mili the shachris, he explains everything that he has to know about shachris, v'hadu parish mili the arvis, and then he goes back and begins explaining things about arvis, about the nighttime. So the Gemara says, not a question. It's a nice question, it was a nice attempt, but it's not really a question because we're starting with arvis with the nighttime because that's what it says in the verse, when you lay down and when you get up. Later on the Mishnah talks about the obligation of the blessings before and after the Shema starts with the nighttime, it starts with the daytime and then the nighttime. The reason is because there's another Mishnah that's stuck in between that begins to speak about the obligation that we have of the daytime, the morning Shema, and once we get to the morning Shema, so we're going to tell you all the halachas about the morning Shema, and then we'll go back to once again talk about the nighttime Shema. But it doesn't come to negate the fact that that the Mishnah over here is starting with the obligation at night, and the reason is because that's what it says in the verse, and also the verse also tells us the obligation that we have to say the Shema itself. Okay, let's go further. Mar said, Amar Mar, Mishasha Kahanim Nichlasan Lechav Chumasan. What is this unusual time that the Mishnah is saying over here? You want to tell me what time to start Shema, so I'll give you a very cryptic code. Well, if you could find out when the Kohanim that were impure were able to eat their Chuma at night, now you know when you're going to start saying the Kri Shema. Michti Kohanim Eimas Kayachli Chuma. So let's take a look, says the Gemara. When exactly do the Kohanim, are they allowed to eat Shuma at night after they start going through the purification process? Mishas Tseis HaKachavim. From the time of Tseis, the coming out of Kachavim of the stars. From nighttime. When are the Kohanim allowed to eat the Shuma? From nighttime. So listen to Mishas Tseis HaKachavim. So let's make our lives a lot easier and stop complicating things over here. The Jews always have to be complicated. This is the first mission in Shnas. Why does it have to be so difficult? May Messiah, when are you going to read the Krishma at night? It should just say, from Tseis HaKachavim, from nighttime. Why are you telling me? Because when the Kohanim were impure, then they would go and they would go to the mikvah, they would be able to eat the Truma. Just tell me, what does that mean? That means nighttime. So why make it so complicated? So the Gemara says the following reason. Milsa agav orche kamashmalan. The Mishnah wants to teach us a side point about the Kohanim when they're allowed to eat their Truma. Emas Kohanim emas kaachli Truma, the Truma. When are the Kohanim allowed to eat Truma? Mishas tseis hakachavim, from the time that these stars come up, from the nighttime. By kamashmalan the kepara loyma akva. So we learn out from here a very important thing. That there's two parts of the process of purification over here for the Kohen. Number one is, after they count their 7 days of abstention from being around holy matters, then they have to go to the mikveh towards the evening time. And the following day, they have to bring what's called a korban chatas, they have to bring a sin offering. So the Mishnah is teaching us the following thing. You might have thought, then until the Kohanim bring their Korban Chatas, they bring their sin offering the next day, they're not going to be allowed to eat the Truma anymore because they have not achieved full atonement for the sin of becoming impure. Says the Mishnah, it's not true. Even only after they go to the mikveh at night, or right before the nighttime comes, they already achieved a status of purity which allows them to once again eat the Truma that night. Either they're not going to bring the Korban, the sacrifice of the next day, says the Gemara, that's how it's understanding the Mishnah, that's not ma'akev, that doesn't get in the way. It doesn't block the Kohanim from being able to eat their Truma. So that's what it says it wants to learn. Kamashmalan Kohanim Amos Kohakli Bitruma Mishash says Kohavim. Kamashman the Kippur Lo Ma'akve. Kiddetanya, like we learned in a pasuk, in a verse, Uba Hashemesh Vatihir. The sun comes, which seems to be meaning that when the sun sets, Vatihir, and the day passes. Bia Shimsha Makvasai. The setting of the sun is what prevents the Kohanim from being able to eat the Truma. Melecho Truma. But it's not the kapara, not the korban that they're going to bring the next day that's going to prevent them from eating the truma. So the Gemara is learning over here very simple, that there's a pasuk that speaks about the kohanim becoming pure, and it says when the sun sets and when the day passes, until that point comes, which means that they also went to the mikveh, until that point comes, they're not allowed to eat truma. But once that the sun has set and the day has passed and they went to the mikveh, so then they're allowed to eat truma. They didn't bring the korban yet, that's okay. They'll bring the korban the next day, they'll get complete atonement for anything that they had done wrong, but they're still going to be allowed to eat the truma here at night. And therefore the Gemara is saying, that's the only reason that we use this unusual language to explain Tzeisah Kachavim nighttime, to teach you an extra halacha by the Kohanim. Umimai dahai, uba shemesh bias hashemesh, vaitir tar yoma. And how do you know, says the Gemara, that when it says the coming of the sun and the passing of the day, that's what it's really referring to, the nighttime, because dilma bias, over turning the page, dilma bias oray, hu umai vitir tir gavra. Maybe it means when the sun is actually the coming of the day. And it means the tahir doesn't just mean the passing of the day. It also means tahir, means purifying of the person. And therefore, how can you bring me a proof from that verse that you want to tell me that the Kohanim are allowed to eat the truma at night before they go to the mikveh? Maybe the verse that you bring me a proof from is exactly the opposite. You brought me the verse to tell me that when the sun is setting and when the day has passed, which means nighttime, and they went to the mikveh, they're now allowed to eat the truma. Maybe the verse is really telling us from when the sun is coming up and the man is becoming completely tahor, completely purified because he brought the korban, he brought the sacrifice, that's when they're going to be allowed to eat the truma. So, Amar Rabba Bar Rav Shila. So Rabba Bar Rav Shila says, "In kein lemakra v'yitahir." Says Rabba Bar Rav Shila, if that would be the case, that the only way that the kain is going to be allowed to eat the truma is when he becomes completely purified by bringing the korban, the sacrifice, the next day, then it should have said over in the verse in a command form, vayitahir, he must become purified through the korban before he's going to be able to eat the truma. My vatihir, why does it say it in a passive manner? Tihir yoima, or tahir yoima, the day passed. The army inchi, like people are known to say, Iarev Shimsha, the sun has gone down, the idchi yoyme, and the day has passed. And therefore we have over here the understanding that when is it that a person is going to read the Kriya Shema? They're going to start reading the Kriya Shema from the time the Kohanim are allowed to eat Truma. When are they allowed to eat Truma? From the time of Tzeis HaKechavim. Why do we say it in this idea of the Kohanim from the eating Truma? Because it teaches this extra lesson that even though you didn't yet bring the Korban, and you have not affected yourself completely in the purification process, the Kohanim were still allowed to eat truma at the nighttime. But we're left over here with the following idea, and that is Kriya Shema, the obligation at night, is learned out from the verse that says, when you lay down, you're going to say Kriya Shema, and that's going to be at nighttime. And what is nighttime? At this point, the Gemara is saying, Tzeis HaKechavim, it's talking about when the stars come up in the sky. Whatever it will be, 40 minutes, 72 minutes, whatever it's going to end up being, but it's going to be certainly when it's no longer daytime, it has to for sure be nighttime. B'ma'arva, b'ma'arava, in the West, you'll keep this word in mind because it comes up throughout Shas. This means Eretz Yisrael, right? The Babylon in Bavel was to the east of Eretz Yisrael, and Eretz Yisrael was in the west. So b'marava in the west in Eretz Yisrael, hi the Rabba Bar Rav Shila lo shemi Elohu. They never heard this statement of Rabba Bar Rav Shila, who explained that it should have said v'yitahir. If you want to tell me that they're not allowed to eat the truma until the daytime, then it should have commanded them to become pure. So therefore, uba'u lo mi boy. Therefore, they have the following question. Hi, uba shemesh bi ashimshoi hu. Umay tir tir yoima. Why do you say that the setting of the sun and the leaving of the day is talking about the nighttime? Aydilma bias orayhu. Maybe like we said before, it means the coming of the day. Umay v'tir taragavra. It means the purification of the person, the kayan, which means that he won't be able to bring to eat his korban. He won't be able to eat the truma until he actually brings a korban the following day. So they didn't hear the explanation of Rabbi Barbar Shila, which says, no, because it doesn't say the Yitahir, so therefore it has to be talking about the nighttime. So the Chachamim in Eretz Yisrael, they answer their own question with the words of the following Braisa. Now a Braisa is another Mishnaic text that was not placed into the Mishnah itself, but very often will overlap the ideas that we find in the Mishnah, and the Gemara will use it as ways to bring supports to what we are trying to say. So he says, so the Gemara says, Vahadar Pashta Le Mibraisa. We learn it out from a Braisa. Midiktani Bebraisa, the Braisa said, Simin Le Dovar. So later on, we're going to see in a few lines that when it says over that you're allowed to eat that the Kohanim were allowed to eat the truma, so it says simin adava, and assigned to that time is Seisa Chachavim, the nighttime. And therefore, says the Say the Chachamim from Eretz Yisrael, we understand from the Braisa, from this text later on, that it must be referring to the nighttime, and therefore the Kohanim bringing their Korban in the daytime is irrelevant to our discussion of when you're going to be allowed to eat, when you're going to be allowed to recite the Kriya Shema at night. Okay, now, you're gonna have to hold on to your, if you weren't holding on yet, to your brains, you're gonna have to hold on tight in the next half of the page. Okay, there is a lot of back and forth. There's a lot of names that we're going to recite of different Tanoim and Amoraim, different sages that we have from the Mishnah and from the Gemara, and we'll try our best to go through it and explain it. I don't have visual aids to make it easier for you, but just try to hold cup, as they say. Says the Gemara the following: Amar Mar. Mar said, "Mishasha kahanim nichnasin lecho b'tshumasan." You said in the Mishnah, the time to recite the Kriya Shema is at night, is from when the time the Kohanim enter to eat their truma, which is, we said, is Tseisa Kachavim, is nighttime. Ureminhu, we have a question on that. There's another Braisa, and the Braisa says, Me'emasai Karna Shema Ba'arvin. When do we read the Shema at night? Same question that we have in our Mishnah, but it answers a different answer. Yeah, Misha'ani Nichnas La'echo Pita B'melach. When a poor man enters into his house to eat his pita, his bread, with some salt. Ad sha'a sha'oimen lepater mitoich sudasai. And when is, until when? Until when are you allowed to read the Shema? Until this poor man finishes his meal. So we said in our Mishnah, keep this in mind, we said in our Mishnah, the most conservative opinion is Rabbi Eliezer, who says, when do you start reading the Shema? Everybody agrees, say so kachavim, when the Kohanim go to eat their truma. And Rabbi Eliezer said, but when, until when are you allowed to read the Shema? Until only the end of the first watching, as we said, which is at least a third of the nighttime. And now the Gemara is saying over here, when is it that a person is going to be able to read the Shema? He starts when the poor man comes in to eat his bread. We don't know exactly what time that is when he comes to eat his bread. Until when can you read the Shema, says the Braisa? Till he finishes eating his bread. Now, presumably, it doesn't take a poor man that long to eat a piece of bread and salt, which means that it seems to be, on the surface, a much shorter amount of time that the Braisa is allowing for this person to be able to eat his, to be able to say the Shema. Says the Gemara, Seifa Vadai Pligya Masnisen, the end of that Braisa, which says, until when can you say the Shema, till the poor man finishes eating his bread, that's certainly arguing on our Mishnah, because as we said, Rabbi Eliezer, the most conservative of all opinions, said, at least until the end of the first watching, which is into the nighttime itself, and here you're eating your bread is going much, much earlier than that. Reisha Mi Lema Pligya Masnisen. Who says that the Reisha, but the first part of the Mishnah, who says that the first part of the Mishnah is arguing, who says that the ratio, that the ratio of this Braisa is arguing on the Mishnah? The ratio is the poor man eating his bread. Maybe it really is Tseisa Kachavim, maybe it's the same time that we had in our Mishnah. So the Sefer for sure, the second part, when he finishes eating his bread, that's arguing on our Mishnah because it seems to be a very early time. But maybe when the poor man comes to eat his bread, that's talking about the nighttime. Says the Gemara, Loi, it's not an argument. Ani v'kayin chad shi'urhu. The poor man, the poor man eating his bread and the kayan being able to eat the truma, it's all chad shiuru, it's all one time. Which means if we said that the kahanim are able to eat truma at seisach hachavim at the night time, that means then over here that the ani, the poor man, is also going to be able to eat his he comes to eat his bread at seisach hachavim. Ay, ura minho, we have another question on this. Another brisa asked the same exact question. From when do we start reading the Krishma at night time? Says the Gemara, Misha Shabnei Adam Nichnas and Lechol Pitam Ba'arvi Shabbosais. The Rameir. Rameir gives another qualification. When the people come home on Friday night and they begin eating their su'udah, they begin eating their meal. Now, we said before that what? That the time to say Krishma is what is going to be Tzeisach HaChavim, is going to be certainly the nighttime. But Rashi points out over here that when people come home Friday night for their meal, the table is set, the food is already made, no preparation necessary. Which means that they're probably eating their meal before it's fully the same dark time hours as we're talking about before. So Rabbi Meir seems to be learning that you can actually eat, you can say Krishna before Seisach HaChavim. V'chachamim oimrim, misha shekhanim zakayin lecho b'truma son. And the Chum said, no, only when the kahanim are able to eat truma, similar number to Seisach HaChavim, that's Seisach HaChavim. So we have a machlekes, an argument of opinions over here. Rabbi Meir saying that you can already say Krishna from the time that people come home Friday night and eat their meal, which is before Seisach HaChavim. And the Chachamim are again holding true to what we said before. When are you allowed to say the Krishma? Only when it's Seisach HaChavim. That's the Machlokes. Now, the next little piece of the Gemara over here is like tangential. We're going to go through it and then we have to come back to this discussion over here. V'afalpi, and even though Shein Raya L'davar, even though I don't have a direct proof to tell you that Seisach HaChavim, that when the stars come up, that is considered to be completely nighttime. Yeah, Zeicha L'davar, I do at least have a hint to that in a verse. Shenema, like it says, V'anachnu oisim b'malacha v'chitzi machzikim b'ramachim ma'alois ha'shachar Seisach HaChavim. It says over there, the people did their work from alois ha'shachar, from the time that the rays of light were coming up, ad seisach hachavim, until the stars came up. Va'oimer, and furthermore, it says in the next verse, v'hayu lanu halayla mishmar, the nighttime was our watching, v'hayoy malacha, and the daytime was malacha, when we do our work. Says the Gemara, my va'oimer, why does the Gemara have to bring an extra verse to teach me over here that the daytime extends from Alois HaShachar, from the first rays of the day, until Tzeisach HaChavim, until the stars come up. It says it in the verse over there. The daytime is when the days of the rays of light come up, and nighttime is when the stars come. So why do you have to tell me? And therefore, the nighttime was for us the Mishmar, when we would be doing our guarding, and the daytime is when we do our work. You don't need that extra verse. We already know day and night from the first verse. Says the Gemara, v'chi teima michi arva shimsha lailahu. Maybe you would say that when the sun sets, which is before the stars come up, that itself is light, that itself is night. V'inhu d'mechashchei. But these people over here, they extended their work even into the darkened hours, but the day ended already when the sun came up. Umekadmi, and they would start doing the work even before the sun would come up, because nates, when the sun comes up, that would be considered daytime. Tashema, v'hayulon alayla mishma v'ayom malacha, comes to teach you that what? The second verse is telling you that when it says tseis, that's talking about nighttime. And when it says amud ha-shachar, the daytime, the rays of light coming up, that's talking about daytime, and that's the day. The day is from the rays of light until these stars come up. And therefore, when is Krishma going to be read at night? Tzeisach HaChavim. So I don't have a clear proof that says that night, that the time to read the Krishma is Tzeisach HaChavim, and that nighttime is Tzeisach HaChavim, but I have a hint from these verses over here that are teaching me that, and that the Gemara says, that's good enough for me. Now, let's go back to what we said before. Do you hold that the times that we're discussing over here about the poor man coming to eat his piece of bread and people coming on Friday night to come to their house is chad shiur, is really the same exact time? We said Is it? Does that mean that it's what? That it's going to be? Is it seis? Is it before it seis? Is it the same time? Because if you will hold that the ani, the poor man, and the kayin, which you said before, the poor man coming to eat his pita, and the kayin coming to eat his truma, are chad shi'uruhu, they're really all one time, which means that's tesuk hachavim, chachamim, the chachamim who said tesuk hachavim, hainu Rabbi Meir. They should be now of the opinion of Rabbi Meir. And Rabbi Meir before said that what? That when b'nei adam nichnasin lecho pitam bar vishav basayis is a different time. If you want to say that an ani, and the poor man eating his bread and the people eating their food on Friday night is the same time, if you want to say that that's true, then you also have to say then that the poor, and you also say that the poor man and the kayin are also the same time, that means that earlier in the Gemara, when we said that Rabbi Meir and the Chachamim are arguing on each other in the times, you're now telling me that they're agreeing with each other in the times. So that can't be. When you have two people saying arguing with each other, you can't come later on in the Gemara and tell me that they agree with each other. They don't agree with each other. So it must be then that the times of either the poor man and the rest of the Jewish people eating their bread on Friday night, or the poor and the Kohanim, which you said was seis, which you said was the nighttime, it must be that one of them is not going to be the same times. So the Gemara says, "Alishma mina." We hear from this, "Ani shiur luchud." The poor man has his own time that he's going to eat his bread. The kayin shiur luchud, and the kayin, this kayin who eats the truma, he also has his own time. So the kayin could be seisuk achavim, and the ani could end up being before seisuk achavim, and therefore we have a difference of opinions in these brises, in these Mishnaic texts of exactly when a person is going to be able to say the Shema at night. But hold on, because we're not done over here. And the Gemara says the following. Again, just keep in mind, these are the hard parts of Daf Yomi. When you have seven different opinions, and you have to get through all of them in 10 minutes, so it makes it difficult, but there are plenty of places online that you can review the daf in a short amount of time. Maybe we'll go through some of the websites that you can take a look at, just so you can hear clearly what they are, but we have to keep pushing over here. So the Gemara says like this. So Rabbi Elishma mina ani shiur luchud v'kayin shiur luchud. Like, no, says the Gemara, ani v'kayin chad shiuruhu. No, I don't agree, says the Gemara. Really, the poor man eating his bread with salt and the kayin and the kayin eating his truma, it's really the same time. The kayin is seisuk achavim, it's the nighttime, and the ani, the poor man, is going to be the seisuk achavim, the nighttime as well. However, the ani b'nei adam lav chachiru, but the poor man and the people that are going to be eating their meal on Friday night, that's going to be a separate time. And therefore, it comes out that what? That the poor man eating the meal and the kohanim eating the truma is tzeisuk achavim, but the poor man is tzeisuk achavim, and the people eating the meal every Shabbos is going to be before tzeisuk achavim, which means that according to that opinion in the Brisa, you'd be allowed to say the Shema even before it's actually tzeis. Okay, let's keep going over here. V'ani v'kayin chachiruhu. Is it true that the poor man eating his pita, which you want to claim now is seis, is nighttime, and the kayin who is eating the truma, which is nighttime, is really this, they do this at the same time? Reminhu, we have another brisa, which is going to be a contradiction to this. In our same question, from when do you begin reading the Shema at nighttime? From the time that you make Kiddush, or from the time that you sanctify the Shabbos on Erev Shabbos. That's Divrei Rabbi Eliezer, and that's called Bein HaShmoshes. Right, another time period. Bein HaShmoshes is Bein HaShmoshes, between the suns. That's really what it means. Which means that when the sun goes down, before the stars come up, that particular time of the day is a suffix. We don't know, is it still today? Meaning, or is it still Friday? Or is it now already Shabbos? So the Gemara says that Rabbi Elazar learns, when are you allowed to start saying Shema? During the time of Bein HaShmoshes, when it's no longer clear to us, is it day or is it night? You're allowed to start, which again, will obviously be earlier than say Sekachavim, than the nighttime. Rabbi Yeshua says, Misha Shakahanim Metuhurin Lechol B'Trumasan. Rabbi Yehuda says, that you're only allowed to say Kriyat Shema from the time that the Kohanim become Tahor, they become pure enough to eat the Truma, which means after they went to the Mikvah, and that's the time of Tzeisach HaChavim. Rabbi Meir Omer, Mishan Shakhanim Toivlin Lechol B'Trumasai. Rabbi Meir learns out what? You're allowed to say the Shema from the time that they are Toivl. Toivl means before Bein HaShmosh, as we'll see. They would go to the mikveh even before Bein HaShmosh. It's even earlier time that Rabbi Meir is claiming that you're allowed to go to that you're allowed to say Kriyat Shema. So Rabbi Yehuda. So Rabbi Yehuda asked a tremendous question on Rabbi Meir. V'alo kahanim mibayd yoyim heim toivlim. The kahanim, they go to the mikveh while it's still daytime out. And you're telling me that that's the yardstick for when you're allowed to say Kriyat Shema at night. So you're telling us that that you're allowed to fulfill your obligation of reading the Kriyat Shema at night before it's even night? Rabbi Meir, how can you even say such a thing? Doesn't make any sense. So let's keep that question because we'll come back to that question. Rabbi Chanina, another opinion, if you don't have enough opinions already, Rabbi Chanina Omer, Misha Sha'ani Nichnas La'echo Pitoi B'melech. Rabbi Chanina goes back to our other opinion, which is at the time that the poor man comes in to eat his pita, to eat his bread at night. So Rav Achai, Va'amila Rabbi Acha, Oimer Misha Sheroi B'nei Adam Nichnasin La'asev, and Rav Achai, and those who say that it's Rav Acha, he says that it's even another opinion, which is the time that the majority of people are finally at home in their houses and they are reclining to eat their meal, which is going to be even a later time. By the time that you get home to eat, you get home different than everybody else does. This, your neighbor comes home at a different time, and therefore everybody has different times that they come home. But by the time that the majority of everybody is home, that's when the obligation to say Kriyat Shema begins, which is a later time. Now, let's go back. If you want to say, if you want to say that the poor man eating his pita and the kohen eating truma is all the same time, which you're saying is Tzeisach HaChavim, the night time. So Rabbi Chanina, who spoke about the poor man eating his pita, Hainu Rabbi Yoshua. He is now, must be the opinion of Rabbi Yoshua, who says, Mishasho kahani mitoin lecho b'tshuma, b'tshumasan, which means that what? They are both saying the same exact thing, which is Tzeisach HaChavim. And again, we have the same problem. You have a braisa, which lists you different opinions. Those opinions are arguing with each other. If you tell me that the poor man eating his bread and the Kohanim eating Truma is the same exact time, that means then that Rabbi Chanina is agreeing to the opinion of Rabbi Yoshua, and in our Braisa they're arguing with each other. So that can't be. So therefore, El Alav Shmamina, Shi'ura the Ani Lechud, Bishir the Kohen Lechud, Shmamina. You're right. So therefore, there's one time of the Ani eating his bread. That's going to be one particular time. And there's one time of the Kohanim eating the Truma, that'll be another time, but they're not the same time. Otherwise, you have this machlekes, you have a problem on the Braisa that two people that are seemingly arguing are really saying the same thing. Okay, so now, Hai Minayim Ha'uchar, so which one of these times is later? Is it the time the Kohanim will eat the Truma, or is it the time that the poor man is going to eat his bread? Which one is the later time? So we want to know right now, who holds that you can't say the Shema until later on in the night? Hai minayim me'uchar, mistabra. It would seem to be the ani me'uchar, that the poor man eating his bread is the later time. Because the i'amar, the ani muktam, because if you want to say that the poor man eating his bread is earlier than the time of the Kohanim, Rabbi Chanina, hainu Rabbi Eliezer, then Rabbi Chanina would have to be holding the opinion of Rabbi Eliezer. El alav shmamina, the ani me'uchar shmamina. El alav shmamina, we learn from this that what? That the ani is me'uchar, is a later hour than the time that the Kohanim would come to eat their truma, which means that the Tzeisach HaChavim of our Mishnah, which is going according to the time of the Kohanim, is going to be an earlier time than when the Ani, the poor man, would end up coming home and eating his bread. The Ani is traveling on the road all day long. He finally gets his little piece of bread, his meager supply over there. By the time that he gets home, says the Gemara, that is later than the time that the Kohanim at Tzeisach HaChavim will be allowed to eat, would be eating their truma. Fine. So we're holding over here in our Mishnah, Tzeisach HaChavim is the opportune time that a person begins to read to do the mitzvah of reciting the Kriyat Shema. And the time of the Ani, which we learn from these braises, that's even later than that, but that's not our Mishnah, these are the braises. Amar, Amale Rabbi Yehuda, Vahala Kahanim, Mibay Joim, Him Toivlim, Shopir Kamale Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Meir, Rabbi Meir. So the Gemara says over here, Amar Mar, Mar said, Amale Rabbi Yehuda, Rabbi Yehuda said, Vahala Kahanim, Mibay Joim, Him Toivlim. Rabbi Yehuda said, the Kahanim, they toivle themselves from Mibay Joim. Remember, Rabbi Yehuda asked a question of Rabbi Meir. How could you say that you can start reading the Krishma at when the Kohanim go to Toivel to immerse themselves in the mikveh, that's still the daytime. And you're talking about the obligation to read the Shema at nighttime. So how can you tell us that you can start reading the Shema at nighttime when it's still the daytime? So Amar the Rabbi Yehuda, V'halo Kohanim Mimboid Yom Him Toivlim, Shopper Kamar the Rabbi Yehuda, the Rabbi Meir. So Rabbi Yehuda has a very good kasha, a very good question on Rabbi Meir. So Rabbi Meir says, no, not so fast. But Rabbi Meir, Hachiko Amar Le. So Rabbi Meir says back to Rabbi Yehuda, Me sover to Anna Ben Ashmosh Didcha? Kaimina? You think that I hold of the Ben Ashmoshes that you hold of? Your Ben Ashmoshes, which your Ben Ashmoshes means, again, these times between the nighttime and between the Friday and Shabbos, you hold that what? That there's a lapse of time. Ben Ashmoshes begins and then it goes what's called a chetzi mil. Half the amount of a mil. A mil is 2,000 amos, and it takes 18 minutes to walk 2,000 amos. It takes 9 minutes to walk half of 1,000 amos, which means you believe that Ben Ashmoshes is a time, and it takes time to get there. And that's why you think that when I said that we go according to the time that the Kohanim are being traveled, that they go to the mikveh, so I must be saying Mibo Yom when it's still daytime, because it's still 9, 10, 12, 15 minutes before it gets nighttime. But no, I don't hold the view. Ana, Aben Ashmoshes the Rebbe Yosi Kamina. I go according to the Ben Ashmoshes of Rebbe Yosi. And Rebbe Yosi, Dam Rebbe Yosi, Ben Ashmoshes Geherav Ayin. Rabbi Yosi learns that Ben Ashmoshes is not a time that elapses of 9 minutes. He learns Ben Ashmoshes is Karain in the blink of an eye. Zen Nichnas Vze Yotze. Shabbos comes in, Vze Yotze, and Friday night goes out. Which means that when I say that the Eiv Shala Amad Alav, and it's impossible for you to know exactly when that moment is. So therefore, I hold, says Rabbi Meir over here, that when the Kohanim Toivel, they toivel exactly on the moment before the nighttime comes, which means that when they are going to the mikveh, when they are getting themselves out of the mikveh, it's already nighttime. So therefore, I hold that when do you have the obligation to Krishna at night? Of course I hold at night. I would never say such a thing. That it means that you can say start saying the Krishna during the daytime. I hold of the Ben Ashmoshes of Rabbi Yosi. Rabbi Yosi Ben Ashmoshes is in the blink of an eye, which means the sun goes down and the moon come and the stars come up. It's at nighttime itself. It's no longer during the day. Kasha the Rabbi Meir, the Rabbi Meir. So we have a question of Rabbi Meir on Rabbi Meir, because Rabbi Meir, as Rashi points out over here, he said originally Shibnei Adam Nichnasim Lechol Pitam Barvishu Basais. And he said that's the time. And here he's saying that it's talking about the time that the Kohanim are going to be toivel themselves. So this seems to be a contradiction of times. So Kash the Rebbe Meir, the Rebbe Meir. Trey Tanai Lib the Rebbe Meir. A famous answer the Gemara will give throughout Shas. When we have a blaring contradiction between a statement that he made in one Mishnah and a statement that he made in another Mishnah, or that he made in a Mishnah or in one Braisa and another Braisa, we say, no, you don't understand. There's two Tanoim, there's two sages named Rabbi Meir. And even though Rabbi Meir over there says one thing, and Rabbi Meir says over here something else, it's two different Rabbi Meirs, and therefore they're allowed to contradict each other. You are right. If it would both be the same Rabbi Meir, we would be left with a very big question over here. He's saying opposites, and you can't say that if you're the same person, you can't say opposites. But when you have one Rabbi Meir over there, and you have one Rabbi Meir over here, then it's not a question. Fine, I'll leave the Rebbe Meir. Kasha the Rebbe Eliezer, or the Rebbe Eliezer. So the Gemara says, we have a question, Rebbe Eliezer, Rebbe Eliezer. In one place he said, the time to read the Kriya Shema is going to be Tzei Sokachovim. And the other Braisa that he says, it's Ben Ashmoshes. So that's two different times. Tzeis is after Ben Ashmoshes, according to everybody. Treyton, I leave the Rebbe Eliezer. Same answer. No, one Rebbe Eliezer who says Tzeis HaKachavim, that's that Rebbe Eliezer. And the other Rebbe Eliezer over here who says Ben Ashmoshes is a different Rebbe Eliezer. And V'ibayis Eimer Reisha Lav Rebbe Eliezer. And then the Gemara gives a very fascinating answer. Maybe I'll tell you like this. If you go back to the Mishnah, And the Mishnah says, Memes HaKarnei Shema Ba'arvin, when are you going to read the Shema? At nighttime. So it says, from the time that the Kohanim enter into each Shema until the end of the first watching. What did, and it says, Diva Rabbi Eliezer. We assumed that when it says these are the words of Rabbi Eliezer, that it was going on both of the initial statements in the Mishnah. Number one, when do you start saying the Shema? And number two, when do you stop saying the Shema at night? The Gemara is saying, no. That Lav, the Resha, the first statement, which is from when do you start reading the Shema, which is when the Kohanim end up eating the Truma, which is Seisuk Chavim, that's not Rabbi Eliezer. That is a general statement that the Mishnah is making. Rabbi Eliezer was only making the statement of until the end of the Ashmur Rishona, which, if you think about it, works out very nice in the Mishnah. Because nobody argues on the first statement of when do you start saying the Krishma. Everybody in Rabbi Eliezer, the Chachamim, Rabbi Gamliel, all agree that the time to start reciting Krishna is when the Kohanim go to eat Truma, which is Seisuk Chavim. Their only machlekes in the Mishnah is, when do you stop saying the Krishna at night? So therefore, it's not such an unusual answer the Gemara is giving over. It's telling you that the Rabbi Eliezer of the Mishnah is only commenting on when is the final time to say the Shema, but everybody in the Mishnah agrees the time to start saying the Krishna at night is going to be when the Kohanim go to eat their Truma, which is Seisuk Chavim. Yashikayach.
Yeah, it's good.